Hey guys, Quiv the Lazy Geek here, and today we're going to talk about thermal noise, dark frames, calibration, and how you can double check that you had the correct exposure time, or at least above the optimal exposure time after the fact when you're checking your pictures in the end. So let's get started. So first things first, one of the things in my previous video on the camera parameters that I forgot to mention, and it was noted to me in a Facebook comment, was the curve that I have here on the computer for the dark current. So the dark current, or the thermal noise, it's basically thermal noise that's introduced to the sensor of the camera, and we can see its unit is electrons per second per pixel. And on this chart, we can see that on the x-axis, we have the sensor temperature. And if we look at it, it looks like a very nice little line there. And it is. The issue that we see here, or what's nice with this dark current, is that we can see that depending on the sensor temperature, it gets very small, very, very quickly. And you can see here on this graph, each step here divides the number by two, right? So this chart is not linear, it's a logarithmic chart. So in effect, you'd see this line here as actually an exponential kind of descending type of line if you were to draw this on a linear graph. And you can see that if I'm using a DSLR in summer, my sensor temperature will be 30 degrees or maybe even more. And so I'm having a lot of thermal noise that's in there. Whereas if I am able to use a cooled camera, then I can really reduce my thermal noise quite a lot. And you can see that roughly by dividing, by removing 5 degrees or so in Celsius of sensor temperature, I'm dividing my dark current by two each time. So there's a very good incentive to cool your sensor. Now, the thermal noise very quickly becomes very small, right? So 0.03, right? 0.01. And especially if you're doing broadband imaging in somewhat suburban conditions, so you have light pollution coming in, which limits the amount of time that you expose, then the dark current becomes insignificant relative to the shot noise introduced by light pollution that we talked about in a previous video very quickly. So if the dark noise is insignificant, it means that there's no more advantage to decreasing the temperature of your sensor very much. So, you know, it's diminishing returns. You still can, but you don't have to. Okay, so we can see how this dark current is. We can see that it's always good to cool your sensor. There's also another advantage to cooling your sensor, which is simply to so that you can take dark frames anytime you like. So if I have a sensor, I can cool it to minus 10 degrees reliably, then I can take my lights, my light frames, my actual exposures of my galaxy or my target or whatever, one day, and then the following night it's cloudy, so I'll just take dark frames at exactly the same temperature. Because we can see that dark frames, they depend on the temperature, but they also depend on the exposure time, right? So we want to, when we take dark frames, we want to match the temperature of the sensor and we want to match the exposure time of your light frames. It's the same thing if you take flat darks or dark flats. You want them to match the exposure time of your flats and you want them to match the temperature of the sensor at which your flats were taken. So having a cooled camera helps a lot in that respect. Okay, so we've talked about this this dark current and how it increases with time and how it also can be diminished with temperature. But the revenue of diminishing the temperature of the sensor will decrease faster in broadband imaging in light polluted zones because it's kind of overwhelmed by the shot noise of the sky glow, whereas in dark areas or with narrowband imaging that have longer exposures and less sky glow, the importance of cooling the sensor becomes even more significant. Okay, so now let's have a look at what, you know, a dark frame looks like. So I'm here now in PixInsight. You can see here I have, this was with my 1600 mm core on the Pelican Nebula, and I exposed each frame for my H alpha filter in narrowband for 480 seconds, and my sensor was at -5 degrees. I wish I could have cooled it more, because the revenue of cooling the sensor would still have been significant. I would have decreased my total noise I computed by around 20%. I digress. I was not able to cool to more than -5 degrees. So I used that, and you can see here we have a dark frame. So that dark frame, I took it by just covering my telescope and you know, exposing for 480 seconds at -5 degrees, also with the same gain and offset as the light frames, because as we saw, gain affects how electrons are counted per ADU, or how many electrons are counted by ADU, and offset affects the bias of your sensor. That's one of the other thing we use. Bias frame, which are very, very short exposures when your dust cover is closed, to measure, you know, the average of the offset caused by read noise and bias and offset. The signal is also included in your dark frame. And that's one of the reasons I do not bother with bias frames anymore, especially since I've seen that some of the CMOS sensors have trouble giving reliable bias frames. So what I do is I just take a lot of darks when it's cloudy out. And since I can match my temperature of my sensor very easily, it's very easy to have a very large library of dark frames that I'll refresh maybe every 6 months or so. And I can just reuse that anytime I want. So because the dark frames include the bias frame current, I don't need to take bias frames if I take a lot of dark frames. Now let's have a look at my dark frame here. We have the dark frame here. We have a master dark, which is an average in this case of 30 dark frames. And I have here my light frame, my H alpha light frame. We are first going to look at statistics of my dark frame. And the reason I'm going to do that is so that you understand why you actually need to stack dark frames. When you're stacking dark frames, you're actually trying to find the average of your bias noise, or your read noise, plus your offset, plus the average of your thermal noise. You're trying to get the average of all of that at once. And if you take a single frame, a single dark frame, there's too much variance in how those noise sources work. There's too much uncertainty, so it doesn't represent that very well. If you start taking many dark frames, you'll be able to average out all of the deviations that you get in single frames to try and diminish that deviation, that average deviation that you get. And in statistics, that average deviation is called the standard deviation. If we look at the statistics of my dark frame, and we're going to look at the average deviation of my dark frame, we see 13.2. That's for a single dark frame. If I look at my master dark frame, we look at the average deviation, it's 12.5. It has diminished. Now, it's not diminished to zero, because obviously you can look at my master dark, and as part of the dark current, some of the pixels will be white, some of the pixels will be dark. So there is definitely a deviation between pixels that is intrinsic to the fixed pattern noise represented by the dark frame. So this average deviation will not go to zero ever for a dark frame, unless you have like a perfectly clean sensor where all of the pixels react in the same way, which is not, you know, possible. So we can see that by averaging out multiple dark frames, we've actually managed to diminish the uncertainty in my master dark. And that means that my master dark will be better at calibrating my light frame than a single dark frame, which retains a lot of the deviations. So something to keep in mind. And the more dark frames, the better, because you are averaging out that deviation more and more. So now let's do some pixel math. And don't worry, we're just going to do a subtraction. I'm going to take my light frame and I'm going to subtract this dark frame. So very easy. I'm going to say light, which is the name of my light frame, minus dark. And we're going to say that we're actually going to create a new image. And we're going to create that image not found. Oh, because I forgot the T here in, at the end of, and I misspelled light here. There we are. I try again, and now we get a new image. And if we stretch it, suddenly it looks much, much better because we've removed the average dark. And compared those two light frames, it's literally night and day. So I'll call that single dark calibration. Okay, and then we're going to do the same thing. We're going to do the with the master dark frame. So I'll just do light minus master dark. And we're going to execute that. And again, we're going to see the result. It looks very similar, right? So at first sight, it almost looks like whatever everything that I said was BS. And you don't need to use a master dark frame, but we'll look at the statistics of those light frames. So I'll call it master dark calibration, so that we remember which is which. And then we're going to look at the statistics, and we're going to look at the standard deviation, so the average kind of deviation of your master dark of your master dark calibrated dark frame, light frame, and we can see it is 11.5, and we're going to check again for the single dark, and then it is 12.64. Even though we're starting from the same frame, the same light frame, with the same amount of signal and the same amount of sky glow, same amount of everything. Because it's the same light frame, and if we calibrate it with a master dark, we get much less uncertainty so than with a single dark calibration. So that's why you want to take many darks, as many darks as possible. And if you take many dark frames, like you manage to take 100 dark frames, then you're really set, because you don't even need to take bias frames. Because, you know, bias frames, the signal that the bias frames measure is already included in your dark frame. And you just need to be careful that when you take flat frames, you also take a lot of flat dark frames as well. So matching darks for your flats and as many as you can. So again, you know, I think that 100 actually is a very good number. Obviously for narrowband, taking 100 482nd dark frames, it takes a long time, but it is doable. It's much easier for broadband, and it's very easy for flat frames. And I think that's what I wanted to show you for this video in terms of, you know, how those dark frames work, what they measure, and what's the impact on your light frame when you do the calibration. The impact is very visible, obviously, but the frame that has been calibrated with the master dark is actually superior to the frame that has been calibrated with a single dark frame. Okay, in the next video, we're going to actually measure the shot noise that I got from both the signal and any sky glow that filtered through my H-alpha filter. And we're going to compare that to the read noise in my image by simulating a 10 by 10 pixel camera sensor with the noise parameter. So we're going to actually verify experimentally how noise sources are added together, and we're going to see that we can verify that our exposure time was correct for any particular sequence. And so you can do that for any of your sequence. It's much easier with a monochrome sensor to double check that you've exposed long enough to actually swamp the read noise. So I'll see you next time for that. It's another technical video, but I think it's going to be a lot of fun. So also, you know, don't forget to look up at the stars, and see you next time.